Hi, welcome back to the course on multi-agent learning. Today I want to discuss multi-armed bandit algorithms because it's an important subclass of multi-agent learning algorithms. Thanks for joining in, and let's just start. So I want to first motivate the idea, explain what the multi-armed bandit problem is. Then I will discuss the difference between online and offline learning in the context of multi-armed bandit algorithms. Then we will discuss an array of simple but very well-known multi-armed bandit algorithms. First, epsilon greedy, which is the most well-known learning algorithm. Q-learning, Boltzmann. Upper confidence bound, which is a parameterless algorithm, so advantage is that you don't have to tune and tweak the parameters. Thompson sampling, which is a well-known but quite involved algorithm. All these algorithms have parameters, sometimes zero parameters like UCB. Some have one parameter, others have two. The more parameters you have, the more tuning and tweaking you have to do in order to get optimize the algorithm. All these algorithms are quite naive, and for multi-agent learning, it is well known that the learning circumstances are not very benevolent to the learner. So these naive algorithms, epsilon greedy, Q-learning, and so on. Are indeed naive in that they don't take into account that payoffs for choices may change during time due to changing behavior of opponents. So an algorithm that is able or that is designed to deal with such adversarial circumstances is X3. And I will discuss that algorithm, and I will conclude with some remarks on dealing with non-stationary time series, which is the case in multi-agent learning, in unevenly spaced observations. So the observations are not regularly distributed in time. I come to that. So, first, how multi-armed bandit algorithms, or what input do multi-armed bandit algorithms need? Well, if you play the game, you are the role player and you have actions A, B, capital A, B, C, D, E at your disposal. Don't watch the numbers in the matrix. They're just there to fill the matrix. And your opponent has disposal or is able to play actions lowercase a, b, c, d, e. Then in the first place, you are not interested in the payoffs of your opponent, and often it is the case that you are unable to observe the payoffs of your opponent. And with simple multi-armed bandit algorithms, it is the case that you aren't even interested or are unable to observe the actions of your opponent. So you don't know or don't care what your opponent does. So you only know what actions you have taken and what rewards per action you got. So for example, in this case, action A was executed twice, and then action C was executed, which yielded a reward of R3, and then action D was executed, which yielded a reward of R4, and so on. Now, it is within reason to average those rewards per action, and then, or to take to keep record of the totals, or to use exponential decay or some other accumulation mechanism. Average is most intuitive, so I will stick to that for the moment. And then if the average reward of arm C is highest, then it is reasonable to choose arm C or action C from then on. I accidentally spoke of ARM because we talk about multi-armed bandits, which we'll explain now. The idea of a multi-armed, well, the problem is called multi-armed bandit problem because you have an array of, you have an array of slot machines, and the problem is which machine to choose. Because maybe one machine is better than the other, and well, the problem is how long do you stick with one slot machine, and maybe other machines are better. So, do you try many machines to explore, or do you opt for security or and safeness, and do you exploit the knowledge that you have? So it is a the main problem of the multi-armed bandit problem is the exploitation versus exploration dilemma. Exploration usually costs you money because it yields less, but it yields information. And exploitation yields money, but it doesn't yield you information about the rewards of other options, other actions, other arms. And then there is the problem, if we want to reason about or theorize about, then may we assume something about the distribution of the payouts? Do slot machines pay out randomly but with a constant mean? So, or for example, you might imagine a scenario where the mean outcome of an action gradually decreases during the night, for example, because in the afternoon to attract customers, and during the night the firm who maintains the slot machines assumes that the audience stays anyway, so he might just as well decrease the mean outcome, the mean payment per slot machine. So then is there a constant variance, stationarity? Stationarity means that the mean more or less stays the same. This is a very intuitive definition. Further on, I will give a very precise definitions of stationarity. So stationary means roughly giving the same outcome, modulo some noise, modulo some randomness. Does a machine shift gears every now and then? For example, shifting gears is a term from poker, when it is advantageous to every now and then change your behavior in order to not to be predictable. So a slot machine at the early evening may pay out generously, and then it may attract visitors, and then it shifts gears and suddenly is very tight in payment. And players may do this as well in an abstract setting of multi-agent learning. They may lure the opponent into generous behavior, like for example in the prisoner dilemma, they may lure their opponent into cooperation. And when their opponent believes that you are cooperating, you suddenly start to defect every now and then. So, yeah. So these are a couple of random questions. This is another visualization of what might happen if you experiment with a number of slot machines. You see that the first machine is very constant payout, so it gives a lot of information, because you already have executed 5 experiments with a constant payoff. So machine 1 exhibits quite some security. And then machine 3 has a higher average payoff, but the variation is also higher. So here you see the dilemma. Which machine should you exploit should you turn to next? Might be machine 3 because it has higher payoff in the average, but also higher uncertainty, higher variation in the payoffs. So there is an exploitation versus exploration dilemma. And in order to give another example, imagine you are at the beginning of a new study year and every fellow student is interested in as a possible new friend. Now, how do you divide your time between your classmates to optimize your happiness? Now, if you are an explorer, then you make friends whenever and wherever possible, just to find out who is who goes along well with you and who doesn't. Well, if you just stick to your nearest fellow student, then you are you might be called an exploiter. Well, what most people, of course, do is first explore and then, well, become more stable about their friendships. Of course, this example doesn't touch upon the problem how quality of friendships is measured and that personalities of friends may be non-stationary, may change. But this is just an informal example. Multi-armed bandit problem has many practical applications. Like the friendship problem, you may imagine a scenario where you have your favorite restaurant has a good quality, but of course there are other options. How do you select the next restaurant? Do you try a new formula or not? That's a problem. Same with Netflix and selecting movie channels. This load distribution among servers, which is the book on the left-hand side, which is a very practical book about medical treatment, is a very, very important application of multi-armed bandit problem. If you have an alternatives for a medical treatment, then of course the rational course of action is to always apply the best treatment up till then, but then you do not explore, so sometimes you have to try suboptimal treatments. Well, that is a problem, and it is it fits within the framework of a multi-armed bandit problem. Adapting routing to optimize network flow. Choosing at any node, at any point in a network, among different roads to other nodes with congestion is a bandit problem, because from history you know that one road tends to have a highest flow, tend to be least digested, but it may change through time. And so this is the same as you drive to work. So you normally use the route that is least digested, but sometimes you want to try something else just to see what happens, and so on. So now I already suggested in the example with the Matrix game that the rewards, you must do something with them, take their averages or just accumulate them in totals, or add them up through exponential decay. I will explain that in a moment. Well, just stick with averages for now. Then we speak of the quality of an action. This is customary terminology in the literature. The quality of an action is, for example, defined as the average reward of an action after n tries. Now the data comes in, the rewards come in gradually. So although this formula is correct, every time that the quality of an action is computed, all rewards must be retrieved. Well, this is called batch learning. And it would be better to have an update formula that computes the new average based on the old average and the new incoming value. And then it would be called online learning. So this is the offline this is the batch version, and in order to create a formula for online learning, we split the average into the previous rewards and the last reward. And we want to turn this term into Q, capital Q, n minus 1. But we have the wrong denominator here. So, yeah, ideally it should be n minus 1 here. So let's do that. Here we have Q minus 1, Q n minus 1, capital Q n minus 1. We have to correct, of course. And this is already an online learning formula, but we wanted to modify it into the traditional learning format. So we separate this into three terms in order to have a learning formula with an alt value, a learning rate, which you see decreases over time. So in the beginning, the learning rate is high, and in the course of time, the learning rate decreases. The goal value, that is the latest reward, the incoming data, and the old value is the old quality of the action. The difference between the two is called the error. Not in the literate sense, but it's just called like that. It's terminology. And the old value is corrected with the learning rate times the error. And then you obtain a new value, Q, capital Q sub n. So we just derived the learning formula for keeping record of the averages without having to calculate the average all over again at each time step. And here you see the quality of each action through time. You see if an action is not executed, the average will decrease. And yeah, so this means the red dots do not indicate time, but they do indicate moments in which the action was executed. And the moments in which an action is executed is distributed unevenly through time. It's not distributed regularly through time. So the x-axis is not a time axis, but an axis that counts the number of times a particular action was executed. And sometimes an action is successful and sometimes it is not. When it is not, of course, the quality of that action gradually decreases. At the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, at the 8th round, the action again is successful, and then for some number of rounds the action isn't successful. Not rounds, but execution of that action is not successful and the quality decreases until it is successful, and so on. And you see that the quality of one action tends to converge. This is an observation now, but you have to prove that. Other than using a learning rate that decreases through time, you can also use a constant learning rate. So you use the same formula. Hold on, I'm switching back to slides now. So instead of a constant, instead of a decreasing learning rate, you may use a constant learning rate. So the formula stays the same, but you, instead of 1 over n, you plug in a constant lambda. And then you will have exponential decay learning. Also known as geometric average. Now, we come now to the first multi-arm bandit algorithm, which is epsilon greedy. So, if you would greedily choose an action at any time, you choose the action that is optimal thus far. So, you will choose the action with the highest Q value. But then, of course, you only exploit and you never explore. So, for this reason, epsilon greedy has been proposed. You choose a small epsilon, and then 1 minus epsilon percent of the time you choose the optimal action, and at other times you choose a random action. Now, it formally follows from a lemma in probability theory, but you can understand it intuitively that all actions are chosen infinitely many times, because at the time a random action is chosen, which happens epsilon percent of the time, any of the remaining suboptimal actions is chosen uniformly. So if there, for example, k, lowercase k, suboptimal actions, then the probability that such a suboptimal action is chosen is epsilon divided by k. And since this happens infinitely many times, it is almost sure here, almost surely, with probability 1, that every action is explored infinitely many times. It is not certain, but it is true with probability 1. If you don't know the difference between that an event is certain and an event has probability 1, think of throwing a dice. It is with probability 1 that eventually the dice will show a 6, but it is not certain, because there is a theoretical possibility that the 6 never shows up. So it is not certain that the 6 will show up, but we know that almost surely a 6 will show up. Almost surely is a terminology from probability theory. So if you head over to the course site, you see interesting links, abbreviations in probability. So interesting links, abbreviations in probability. And yeah, almost surely. A statement of probability that holds with probability 1. Almost certainly. So there are quite a lot of terms in probability theories that I will use throughout, and you will find them with interesting links and then abbreviations of probability. So if each action is explored infinitely many times by the law of large numbers, the estimated value of an action converges to its true value. And all this with probability 1. So most of these theorems and results are almost surely, and not certainly, and not with certainty. Now, the alternative for epsilon greedy is to work with optimistic initial values. Now, at the outset, the quality of every action is set unreasonably high. Unreasonably And then the average profit is maintained, and then the algorithm is without exception always exploit the machines with the highest Q values. Now the less well performing arms will very quickly decrease their quality from unreasonably high to their true quality. This algorithm works, but you have to check a few things. Initially, of course, many actions are tried because the initial quality of all actions is set unreasonably high. How do you know that all actions are tried? Well, you have to set up the quality of, you have to be sure that the initial quality of every arm is high enough. But how high is high enough if you do not know the rewards of the arms in advance? And, well, you always exploit. Can we still speak of exploration? Yes, there is exploration, but how does that work? And for exploration greedy, we know that the probability that every action is explored infinitely many times is 1. This is also the case with optimistic learning. This is a question, and I encourage you to think about it. And absolute greedy works with slot machines with infinitely many actions, and optimism works differently, and it may or may not work with infinitely many slot machines. So again, I encourage you to think about this problem. If you compare the two algorithms, epsilon greedy and optimistic with starting value of 5 and always exploits, and here you have epsilon greedy with starting value of 0, starting quality of 0, and probability of exploring 10%. You see that in this scenario, optimistic learning executes suboptimal actions less often, eventually, because it doesn't explore. But again, the conditions have to be there in order to function. So optimistic needs more conditions in order to function than epsilon greedy. Epsilon greedy is more requires less in order to function. If you want to know more about epsilon greedy and optimistic learning, consult section 2.8 of reinforcement learning of Sutton and Bartow, the edition from 1998. Not the latest edition, because it's not officially issued, but the edition of 1998. A variation on epsilon greedy learning is Q learning. It works the same, but instead of maintaining an average, you maintain a so-called moving average or rolling average. So it works the same like epsilon greedy, but instead of maintaining an average, you maintain a moving average. So 1 minus epsilon of the times you choose an optimal action, and epsilon time percent of the time you choose a suboptimal action. And you update in the same way as in epsilon greedy. Sorry for the typo, by the way. But then with a constant learning rate. You see? A disadvantage of Q learning is that it possesses two parameters, an exploration rate like epsilon greedy, but also a learning rate, lambda. So disadvantage of that is that you have to tune two parameters, which may take more time. Now, I encourage you to think about what happens if to pause the video for a moment and think about what happens if epsilon is small and gamma is large, or the other way around. Okay, let's move to the next slide. So greedily exploiting the action that is optimal thus far, you can also choose your next action proportionally. So you know the qualities up to now of all actions recorded through averages or to exponential decay by Q-learning or through maintaining totals, which works differently than averages, by the way, which you will see in the next course. And then select randomly and proportionally to the expected payoff. In that way, you you give advantage to well-performing actions, but you give less performing actions, suboptimal actions, an opportunity to join as well. Another way to choose among your actions is through softmax. Softmax comes in different guises or have different names. Often used names are Boltzmann or mixed logit or quantum response function. Peyton Young uses the term quantum response function. And quantum response function is more common in econometrics, as I believe. And it works like proportional selection, but then the quality is raised to the power q. Why raised to the power q? Because if you multiply with the constant factor, then it doesn't matter, because the multiplication factors even or cancel each other out in the numerator and denominator. So you have to do something with the exponentials. And you divide by a parameter tau, which is often called the temperature. And in a moment, I will explain why it is called the temperature. So let's move on to the next slide. So this is again the softmax function. And this function favors successful actions. And how much depends on the temperature tau. If the temperature is high or goes to infinity, then the distinction between optimal actions and suboptimal action blurs. So the optimal actions are here, the red and the, so here are kind of 10 different actions, or what is it, 12? No, 10. And those two actions, red and green, are the optimal actions. But you see, if tau is high, then the softmax doesn't distinguish between optimal actions and suboptimal actions. If tau is near 1, then you see that optimal actions are favored. And if tau goes to 0, it cannot be 0 because you divide by tau. But if it's close to 0, decreases from above to 0, then the suboptimal actions are marginalized. Now it springs to mind that I have a netlogger demo about this, so let's see if I can find it. Doesn't respond. So you see here an action list with five different actions, and the quality of action 1 thus far is 2, the quality of action 2 thus far is 8, the quality of action 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 thus far is 10, And if I said lambda is high, then you see that the softmax, which is red, evens out. I can if I set it high, then you see that softmax evens out. If I decrease lambda, then let it go to zero. Oh, and I understand why I let it. If you let it to zero, then you see that the most profitable action, the optimal action, is favored. You see, lambda goes to zero. Now, if lambda is zero, then it will get an error. The slider forbids it to go to zero for obvious reasons. But you see, the suboptimal actions are marginalized. This doesn't have a function. So that's the idea. Okay. So another very important algorithm is for choosing among actions is upper confidence bound. It comes in different guises. What I discuss now is upper confidence bound 1, UCB1, proposed by Lai and Associates. And the idea is to keep track of confidence intervals for every action and at any time choose the action in that confidence interval with the highest upper bound. We'll show a picture of this in a moment and a give a demo of this in a moment. And this is often advocated as optimism in the face of uncertainty. Because if you are uncertain about an action, the confidence interval is wide and the tendency to choose that action is high. But if you come to know more about an action, the confidence interval becomes narrower and the tendency to choose that action is smaller. Now first we'll give the algorithm. It doesn't make it, I think this formula doesn't make sense right now, but I'll just give you the algorithm, then we'll explain it. So first you start to execute each action once in order to obtain averages. You can't start the algorithm right away because you divide by the number of times an action is executed. Now if you at the outset of the algorithm you execute each action once, the n sub t becomes 1 because n sub t I, so there should be an I here, is the number of times an action I is executed at around t. So this is a typo, there should be a sub I here. So how UCB works is that you keep track of the averages on the one hand and keep track of the upper confidence bound on the other hand. Now the averages is an exploitation term because this gives knowledge about the quality of an action. And the confidence bound, upper confidence bound, gives information about the knowledge you have about that action. If you have little knowledge about the payoffs of that action, then this term is high. And if this term is high, it invites or it asks you to execute that action, because at any round you have to choose the action that has the highest upper confidence bound. Okay, so here's an explanation. So we have a couple of actions from to choose from, and at any moment you have empirical means. So the empirical mean, which is a scientific word for average, practical average, or average observed, for the three actions, the first three actions are equal, and for the action 4 and 5 are equal. But you see that information about the payoff of action 2 is higher than the information about the payoff of action 1. They have equal means, but different empirical variance. So with action, so look at action 4 and 5. Which action would you choose? Action 4 or 5? Well, in terms of certainty, you would choose for action 4 because you have less variance. But if in terms of exploration, you would choose for action 5 because little is known or less is known about the values, this higher variation. So you choose the action with the highest upper confidence bound, which is action 5. So hence the term optimism in the face of uncertainty. Yeah. So, we have five arms here, five different actions, of which the second and the third arm are optimal, but you as a learner doesn't know, of course. And the fourth and the fifth and the first are suboptimal, and the fourth and the fifth have equal values as well as the second and the third to make the problem more interesting. Now at the first round, before running the algorithm, each action is executed once. So the payoff of by its initialization of the first action is minus one, slightly less than minus one. The payoff of the second action is slightly less than two. So slightly less than two, which is a bit above its mean. And of the third action as well. And the fourth and the fifth action should be the expectation of the first and of the fourth and the fifth action is around zero. Well, the fourth action, the first payoff is one, and the payoff of the fifth action is below zero. And then, the confidence bounds are not known yet because action has been executed only once for each action. And now we're going to step through the UCB algorithm. So white means reward. So apparently, at any case, the arm with the highest UCB is chosen. The UCBs are set to according to the formula. Are set to the average plus 2 times ln, in this case 1, because we are in round 1, and each action has been executed once, so this is also a 1. With the highest confidence bound, and the intervals will adapt accordingly. Now, each time the UCB chooses that action that has the highest upper confidence bound, in this case, is the third action, and the upper confidence intervals bounds are updated, and so on. The labels indicate the number of times an action has been chosen. So if we let the algorithm run, we see that the algorithm has a tendency to keep the upper confidence bounds on an equal level, either because an action is optimal. Well, let's stop it for a moment. Either because the action is optimal, or else because an action is suboptimal and has been chosen less often. Okay. So let's redo the experiment a couple of times. Let's restart. You see that, eventually all actions will be chosen infinitely many times, and explain that in a moment. And so on. Now let's perform the experiment with higher deviation in rewards. And let's restart a couple of times. And you see that is a higher deviation. The UCB may be left astray because of an unfortunate payoffs. Here it goes in the right direction, but here it goes in the right direction. Here it goes in the wrong direction, you see. And because of an unfortunate payoff of, and here it picks up. So if the deviation is high, then UCB may converge to on the suboptimal arm, and these are the two. The two suboptimal arms that are likely to converge to. I will say more about it a bit later. Now, how do we come by this term? It is simple enough to explain. Otherwise, I won't explain because theory is quite involved, but here we can explain it. We have Hövding's inequality, which says that for independent and identically distributed random variables with a fixed mean and values in the unit interval, says that the probability that the real mean lies outside the empirical mean plus the radius is small up to a certain extent, but it is at least not higher than this value. And you can make this term or this expression as small as you like by making D as large as you like. Now this is Hövding's inequality. There are more versions of Hövding's inequality. This is the most simple one. So x bar sub t is just the average of the observations. Now if you specialize this to every action, you have to index it with a letter I. And well, the expression remains the same. Now, the probability that the true mean mu lies outside this interval goes to zero if we set this term, which is effectively, this term, equal to an expression that goes to zero if t goes to infinite, if t comes large. So it turns out with hindsight that the term t to the power minus 4 is convenient. So he says if we set this term equal to t to the power minus 4, then we have the guarantee that this expression will go to zero, because this expression will go to zero. And the probability that the mean is outside, well, that the mean is outside this interval goes to zero. So what value of d do you need? Well, just have to isolate d from this equation, and that yields the upper bound of the confidence interval. So in the course of time, this upper bound of the confidence interval becomes more and more safe. It excludes less and less the probability that the true mean lies outside this interval. Now, I already told you that all arms are pulled infinitely often, and you can easily understand this by thinking about what happens with an arm if it's not pulled. And if an arm is not pulled, just watch this term. What happens if an arm is not pulled? Then this number becomes larger and larger, and this number remains constant. So what happens with this value? It becomes larger and larger, and eventually the confidence interval becomes wider and wider, very gradually, because you take the logarithm of the number of rounds, so it becomes wider and wider very gradually, logarithmic in time, but it becomes wider, and eventually it is taken to be selected. Now, if you have the means of the distribution of the arms, then let's capital I be the arms that are optimal. Argmax is selecting those indices for which the means are optimal. That can be proven that the number of times a suboptimal arm is played can be bounded above by a term that is logarithmic in the number of rounds, here denoted by capital N, up to a certain constant. And it can also be proven that this is the best we can get, up to this certain constant. These are very loose bounds. So if you, for example, if you have the constant 8 and number of rounds is 20, then it is possible to have 11 out of 20 times playing the suboptimal action. Now, I discussed only one variant of UCB. UCB 1 was discussed here. There were many more variants. I want to show you one additional thing about UCB, which I noticed yesterday, that it was claimed that UCB may converge to because this term goes to infinite, grows without bound if the number of rounds increases. It was claimed in the literature somewhere that UCB may convert to a suboptimal arm, like what is shown in the demo here. Eventually it picked up on the optimal arm, but for a long time it was misleaded into converging to a suboptimal arm, but the authors claimed that it was possible to. And I read this in the monograph of Powell and Rizov, and that is here. Here I have the same reasoning, but furthermore, the bound grows to infinity as n goes to infinity, because this is the bound and grows to infinity, obviously, which once again indicates that an optimal policy can converge to a suboptimal arm. So the authors claim that it is possible for UCB to converge to a suboptimal arm, and that this one of the suboptimal actions, in this case this action, is is preferred over the other actions. I want to discuss another sampling algorithm, another learning algorithm, because it is mentioned many times, and I think you need to have knowledge of that algorithm, is Thompson sampling. And the idea is, for each arm, use a parameterized probability density function, PDF, as a hypothesis for its rewards. I will show pictures of this in a moment to illustrate what I mean. For example, for the Bernoulli multi-arm bandit problem, which is, every arm consists of tossing a biased coin. So every arm gives rewards either 0 or 1 with a fixed probability. So for example, the first arm gives 0s and 1 with the probability half and half. And the second arm has a mean of 0.8 and gives heads 80% of the time. And the third arm has a mean of 0.4 and gives heads 40% of the time. So gives ones 40% of the time, and so on. Now, this could be modeled by so-called beta distributions with parameters alpha I and beta I. One for every arm. Now, for every action, start out with the neutral distribution, the prior probability distribution. I will show you in a moment how that looks like. And for the Bernoulli multi-arm bandit problem, this should be the beta 1-1 distribution. At every round sample, all hypotheses, so sample all distributions that you now have, and choose the arm which samples highest. And then you update that distribution, because you know you have more information about the performance of that arm, and you update the corresponding beta distribution. The starting distribution is called the prior distribution, and the updated distribution is called the posterior distribution. So you update the distribution, you get the posterior probability density function, and this effectively what you do is that's called a Bayesian update. So for example, if arm 5 pays 0, you increase beta with 1, because it draws the beta distribution to the left hand side. I will show you in a moment. And if this arm pays 1, you will increase alpha, because it draws a, making alpha increase, draws the distribution to the right hand side. So this is what it looks like. So for example, you have 4 arms, and arm 2 has never been experimented with, so it has the beta 1-1 distribution, you see? It's a uniform distribution from 0 to 1, with the surface below it is 1. So probability density function has always have to integrate to 1. So the surface below the graph is 1. You see, 1 times 1. And arm 1 has been pulled 3 times with 2 successes. So alpha has been increased 2 times and beta has been increased 1 time. You see here, alpha 2 times and beta 1 time. So more successes than failures, which means that the beta distribution has a tendency to move to the right. It's not as steep as the beta distribution of arm 4, because arm 4 is more experimented with. It is experimented 7 times with 1 success. So most of the times were failures. So alpha has been increased 1 time, which yields 2, and beta has been increased 6 times, which yields 7. And you see that the beta distribution of the fourth arm has a higher peak, because it has more information. We have more information about ARM4. Okay, so far Thompson sampling is a lot more to say about it, but just to give you an idea what Thompson sampling is about, it is about maintaining probability density functions. And each time you will take an action, you sample the probability density function, so you let the probability density function, for example, of ARM4 generate a number given by the probability density function. And for ARM4, it is likely that this number is low because of the distribution. And you do that for all four arms, and you choose the highest sample. And of the arm that gives the highest sample, you pull that arm. That's the idea of Thompson sampling. Okay, so far about Thompson sampling. Now, what these algorithms have in common, epsilon greedy, Thompson sampling, Q-learning, and so on, is that the UCB, is that they assume that the payoffs of all arms are stationary, more or less. And this is usually not the case. At least it's not the case in multi-agent learning. Because the payouts of different action in multi-agent learning highly varies through time. This is because opponents may shift gears, and well, it seems to be the norm in multi-agent learning. For example, in chicken, one party wants to coordinate, but the other party wants to anti-coordinate. So at any time, you want to act differently depending on what his opponent does, and same as chicken. So this concept was invented only as late as in 1998 by Auer and Cesar Bianchi. They assume that the opponent may use any reward algorithm, and in the worst case, an adversarial bandit is benign. That is, if it is smart, it must frustrate a learning algorithm. And if it is omniscient, that means it knows everything, it is super intelligent and knows everything. Hyperintelligence is omniscient or alwetend in Dutch. It may frustrate a learning algorithm to the max. So hence the name adversarial bandit. Now, small exercise for you. Suppose you are a benign adversarial playing against a fictitious player which you want to drive crazy. How would you play? You see that you don't care about your own payoffs. These are all zero. Your own payoffs as a column player are zero, but your row player wants to coordinate with you. You see? Wants to coordinate. Heads, heads, or tail, tails. How would you play to drive the row player crazy? That's the problem. Now, the problem with cumulative algorithms, so I want you to think about that for a moment and think about an algorithm that drives the role player crazy. Now, the disadvantage of epsilon greedy, UCB, and so on is that they are maintaining an average payoff, and you know that averages respond very slowly to sudden changes. Can show you that as well. Yeah, so green represents average of all points in 2D, and yellow represents geometric mean. Notice how slow average changes. So this is the average of all the points clicked. So the green is the average between all the points clicked. These are the points clicked, the red crosses. This is the average, you see, just in the middle. And the geometric always adapts 1/3 between the between the last value and the new value. So let's select another value. The averages is the center of this triangle, of course, the centroid, and the exponential update, the geometrical update, is 1/3 between the last observation, the last value and the last observation. Now see how slow the average changes through time. Just click randomly. You see the geometrical update does the same every time, 1/3 between the last value and the last incoming data. But you see that the averages change more slowly. So the geometrical mean is able to adapt quickly, you see, but the average is not able to adapt quickly. Well, I think you get the idea. So for that end, XPRI is designed by Auer and Associates only in 2002. It's quite recent algorithm. And they also introduced the term adversarial bandit. Exponential weight algorithm for exploration and exploitation. And XPRI may be seen as a volatile softmax, so volatile means bewegelijk. It very quickly adapts to changing circumstances. It's an adversarial algorithm, meaning that it should perform well in environments where payoffs for actions may suddenly change, even for the worst. And the idea is to maintain a vector of action weights, and actions are chosen probabilistically proportional to their weights. And this is the exploitation term, and this is the exploration term. You see, 1 minus gamma of the times you exploit proportionally to the weights, and gamma of the time you explore uniformly, hence the name egalitarianism factor. Sorry for the pronunciation. As a thought exercise, check what the formula does if gamma is 0 or 1. Now, how are the weights determined? Well, that's a bit of a mystery, and it follows from the theory, which is too much to explain here, but must be explained in order to know how the algorithm works. This is called the estimated reward. It is the actual reward divided by the probability that it occurs. So the probability that it occurs, the frequency that it occurs, and you divide by the probability. Why? Because if an action gives a high reward, but it has a tendency not to be selected that often, you should give it a high estimated reward. So is the philosophy. As the same philosophy, by the way, as the upper confidence bound, only more to the extreme. And the weights are then updated as the weight in the next round for action I is the weight of action I in the previous round times e to the power gamma times 1 over k times the estimated reward. This is not very transparent, but let it suffice to say that the updates are more volatile, tend to follow trends more flexible. As with UCB, the rewards are supposed to lie in the unit interval, but you can always scale your payoffs. And the important property of XPRI, as well as UCB, is that it has no regret, at least in the weak sense, which means that the average regrets are pressed out. The phrase has no meaning to you yet because we haven't discussed regret, but it means that on the average, you tend to choose the optimal actions. So I already indicated that most of the algorithms presuppose stationary time series. Now, a time series is called strictly stationary if through all time intervals the distribution is the same. So irrespective of time and the length of the time interval, these vectors are identically distributed. This is official definition. You may forget it, but this is, I have to show you at least once the official definitions. And weakly stationary of order 2 if it has a fixed mean. So this is intuitive. And for each fixed length of the interval, the covariances between observations are equal. That means that the statistical data, at least the mean, is fixed and the covariances is fixed throughout intervals. Strict means that all statistics, whether it is variance or mean or higher moments, are all time independent, which is quite an unrealistic assumption, too harsh of an assumption. And weak if means or implies that you have constant mean. This condition implies that you have constant variance and covariance. However, other statistics, so statistics of higher moments, are free to change. And it is quite a more realistic assumption. Now, with stationary time series, so if you have a constant mean, then maintaining the quality of an action by average or by moving average, you see that in the last phase the rewards were a bit higher, is quite a good method to keep track of the time series. So with stationary time series, average and mover averages work quite well. However, with non-stationary time series like this one, the average, also known as the empirical mean, I've written here out for the sake of convenience, and the moving average is also known as the rolling average, geometric mean, or exponentially smoothed mean, written out here for the sake of convenience, are bad predictors, as you will see. So you see the moving the average is here, it's just the average of all the black values, but it is in no way a good prediction of the value in the next iteration. And the moving average is, well, a bit better because it averages more to the tail of the observations, but it is in no way a good prediction because it doesn't take into account the trend of the true values. So in reality, with multi-agent learning, you have different arms with different payoffs. Of course, you tend to choose those arms that at any time that has the highest payoffs, at least that you estimate has the highest payoff. So the solid lines here are the true payments in every round. You as a learner has to estimate those true payments. Sometimes you pull a wrong arm. For example, here you should have pulled either red or brown. You choose the red arm here, but you should better have pulled the brown arm or the green arm. And here you have pulled the blue arm, but you have better pulled the red arm here. And why is that? Because you only observe payoffs of arms when you actually execute them, when you actually pull them. That gives us an unevenly spaced time series. So you don't see, well, you don't see the blue line, but you do see your observations. And from those observations, you have to make predictions, which is quite a difficult problem. And it actually is the problem of dealing with unevenly spaced time series, to predict unevenly spaced time series. Your job is to predict, as a learner, given these two observations here, given this cluster of observations here, and given these observations here, what is the next value of the blue arm in this round and the next value of the red arm in this round, which is quite a difficult job if you come to think about it. So what is the position of multi-armed bandit algorithms in Milzane's learning? Well, there's lots of theory and methods and techniques are known to analyze and predict regular time series or evenly spaced time series, because they are used in all kinds of branches where you can, where you have control of the measurements. So in finance, you can say, I measure every hour. And in astronomy or physics, you can say, I measure every second, or I measure every day. So then you have a regular time series, and there are lots of theories and techniques known to deal with regular space time series. However, unevenly spaced time series are less well understood. You can interpolate empty intervals, and there's a Python library who does exactly this, the Traces Python library. But there are other techniques that take irregular time series as they come, without interpolating, without transforming them into irregular space time series, because you can make all kinds of bias errors with that. If you transform an irregular time series into a regular time series, you can make all kinds of mistakes. And these techniques are quite advanced. I named them for the sake of completeness, like state space analysis, Kalman filtering, autoregression, stochastic differential equations, to name a few. And it really goes too far and beyond the scope of multi-armed bandit algorithms to discuss those. Then, rather to over-engineer multi-armed bandit algorithms for multi-agent learning, is perhaps better to take advantage of the information that a game gives to learn. For example, your own payoff matrix, moves your opponents, hypothesized strategy, and so on. We will discuss this in Fictitious Play and No Regret Learning. The next presentation will be about reinforcement learning, as it is discussed by Hobart Peyton Young in his monograph Strategic Learning and its Limits. Okay, thank you for bearing with me. Thanks for watching, and hope to see you on the other side of this presentation. Bye.